Okay, now the music stopped. I think he wants me to go. Okay. Yeah, this talk is about XDP. So I like to frame it, what will you actually get out of this? So what will you learn during this talk? I tried to adjust it to the audience, like you're already kernel developers, but from different subsystems. So I'm actually going to introduce you a little bit to some of the network, the data structures we have, so you might actually have a chance to understand my slides. And then you hopefully already heard about XDP, but I wanted to hear about who already knows what XDP is. For hands, who knows? Yes, seen all my talks before. Yeah. I can actually see the colors on the screen. I actually on my laptop I have green and yellow, but here up here is all yellow. So sort of colorblind, yeah. That's the projector. Let's see how it goes anyhow. So I'll actually go into and explain why the network stack people did this and why David actually accepted this stuff. And then I'll go into even more future crazy ideas that I'll try to, like, so David is here so he can hear some of the crazy ideas so he won't yell too much at me when he sees the patches. So, and I'll also explain how we actually want this XDP stuff, which can actually bypass the kernel, to cooperate more with the network stack. And as a last takeaway, you will get, I'll give you an easy way to try out XDP and run BPF code and play with this on your laptop. So you have to wait until I'll reveal the GitHub place where you're going to clone this from. So in the first place, why was this needed? This was actually for the network stack to staying relevant, because we were seeing these emerging use cases where people were claiming the network and the kernel were inherently too slow. But that was because the network stack assumes that we had layer 7 at least layer 4 delivery, and then when you compare that with a bypass solution that works on a lower layer 2 to layer 4, then obviously it's faster. Down in the corner for the non-network people, I have written the OSI model of the layers of Ethernet and IP and whatnot. So, but with XDP we can show this that we have the same performance as these performance or these kernel bypass. There are some situations where for example DBDK is faster, but I'm okay with that. I just want to be within like 10% of these kernel bypass solutions. Then I'm actually quite happy. I'm willing to take a little bit more overhead to be generic. So what kind of monster did I create or did we create in the network stack? Well, it is XDP in itself is, oh, is there something weird sound? Is a new programmable layer in front of the traditional network stack. You actually put a whole layer in front of the network stack. I don't know how David accepted that. And there we can actually read and modify and drop and redirect these packets, which is kind of heavy operations that we can do that without the network stack seeing this stuff. We do get this really impressive performance boost, and that's, I guess, why we let it in. So the idea is that this is still in kernel, and we can accelerate some of these layer 2 to layer 3 use cases, for example, forwarding. But we also have something new called AFXDP, which is the address family XDP socket. And let me see, where are they? The maintainers and authors of that are also here in the room. So that is sort of what I call a hybrid kernel bypass facility. You can deliver raw frames into user space. So this can actually bypass the kernel. So, and this is single producer, single consumer queue. That's part of the performance gain. Let's talk a little bit more about this AFXDP. So yes, I did say we could bypass the whole kernel by this facility. But we build in freedom so people can do what they want. So we can do this. And DBDK already have a polymer driver for AFXDP. And I also believe the DBDK maintainer is here. Yeah. So that's good to see that we are getting that DBDK is also using our stuff. So, but why do I believe this is better than the other bypass solutions? That is because we are sharing the NIC resources. So, what we did is that we let the XDP program or BPF program filter the packets and choose which packets by the redirect action that we want to put into the AFXDP circuit. That gives us a lot of flexibility of only optimizing or caring about the fast path packets we care about, and then we can let the kernel handle the rest. And a very important thing is that we don't need to re-inject these frames that we chose not to handle in our fast path, because we just choose not to redirect them. And we can leverage existing kernel infrastructure and the ecosystem and all these things. So how can XDP be used or abused? So we did give the freedom to shoot yourself in the foot. That's a good Unix philosophy. So first, a little bit about a simple view on how XDP gains speed. One is that we avoid memory allocations, and not just avoid the memory allocation of our SKB buffer, but also the init of it, which is four cache lines. So, and then we also do bulk processing of frames, and next trick is we get very early access to the frame just after the DMA sync. So that is, and the red code, the red color actually gets up here. Oh, but yeah, and then another trick is that we skip a large part of the code, which is also a really efficient way of gaining speed. So the most efficient code is code that doesn't run. So that's the most easiest way to optimize the code, simply don't run it. And if we can skip it, we can get gains on speed. But that also means that we are skipping some features that we are providing by the network stack. So we gave the users the freedom to skip the net filter part, and that's a conscious choice they have to make. And also, for example, skipping the route lookup. But then users come back to us and say, hey, but I actually needed this feature. And then they have to re-implement the whole thing in BPF. And what's usually way to do this is creating these BPF maps. And it's sort of getting cumbersome for people to like represent the whole routing table in a BPF map, and the kernel already have access to this. So you can avoid re-implementing features, and it goes into what David talked about, that we can evolve XDP by creating these helpers. And these helpers are sort of a way to export or giving the BPF program access to kernel tables in different kinds. And when we define the helpers, we do define an API or user space API that we must maintain for a long time. So, like David said, we have to discuss the helpers if they make sense or not. So, we really want to encourage people to add helpers instead of duplicating these things in maps. You can still duplicate it in maps, but it requires more maintaining of these maps in user space. So instead, I want people to see XDP as a software offload for the existing network stack. In that way, you simply set up how you would normally set up your network stack for routing packets or something. And then you accelerate parts of it with XDP. A really good example is that David Ahern, he added a helper for doing a lookup in the route table. So we have that today. And that is really nice because we can let the existing router daemons maintain the routing table and everything. And we will just have a helper from the BPF program to look up in the table if the entry is not there, or the entry is there but there's no the next hop is not resolved in the neighbor table, we'll just fall through and let the kernel handle this packet. And then the kernel will then do the neighbor discovery or the up lookups. And the next packet that comes in, we will be able to accelerate. So we are accelerating only the fast path and then fall back. In case we detect that we don't have the full information, we'll let the Linux network stack, the last 25 years of work, like do the job for us. One next obvious target is a bridge helper lookup. I always expected people would do that first, but we didn't. So it's like the routing lookup. We can transparently accelerate some parts of the bridge forwarding and then fall back because we don't have flooding support now in XDP because we don't have a clone facility. We might want to add that. And that is obviously will get a boost for Linux bridging, which is used quite extensively. So now you'll get some information about how to understand the next slide. You need to understand some structs that we are using in the network stack. So we have some fundamental structs that are describing the data frame and keeping information about that at different levels. So we have our good old SKB, and the kernel is called SK_buff. The name indicators is destined for sockets. It's a socket buffer. And we allocate that from the slab or the KMM cache. Then we also have something called, there's two different XDP structures, one called XDP buff. It is sort of actually not allocated, it's just on the call stack. When we call the XDP program, it contains pointers and some information, and it has to have the full pointers because the BPF verifier needs to know that it can prove different things from this buffer that we are not getting out of bound. Then we have something called XDP frame, which is a state compressed version of the XDP buff, but it is placed on top of the data frame to avoid any allocation. And the idea here is that once we need to queue this object or redirect it or send it somewhere else, we won't have the XDP buff, which is allocated on the stack. So we need to put this information somewhere else. So we put that in the top of the frame. That's actually the same as DBDK does. It has its mbuff in top of the frame. Then we have this hardware-specific descriptor with some information and a pointer to the data that was DMA'd in. And it contains some hardware offloads, which a lot of the rest of the talk is going to be about how do we transfer this, because today it gets transferred down in the driver to the SKB. Some exotic details to understand some of the other slides, that we also have something called the SKB shared info, which is placed also inside the data frame at the end. And we use that for stuff that uses multi-frames, like generic receiver offloads, the jumbo frames and stuff like that. And then we have XDP receive queue info stuff that is static information per receive queue info. This actually allows us to have different memory models per receive queue in the drivers, and this is also how we managed to get the AF XDP zero copy stuff going. What? The generic receive offload, which is the software version of TSO. So that is, yeah. But it's a good point that I actually needed to describe some of these structures because some of the network terminology is not like as I expected everybody would know what GO was. But yeah, that's good information. So evolving XDP. So now we can talk about my crazy ideas. Now you know these data structures, and now I'm going to juggle these data structures to get something funny out of it. And this stuff might never get implemented, and if Dave shakes his head when I'm doing this, I know it won't get in. Or if, even if he like just does like this. Then. Yeah, exactly. I'm trying to convince him now. So one crazy thing I want to do is that I want to move the SKB allocations out of the NIC drivers. That's a fairly big step. That would, the goal would to be to simplify the drivers and to create this inside the SKB, inside the core code. And I've sort of already snuck this in the network stack because I've done this in two places. Today we have this XDP frame I talked about before. It can actually get redirected into the VTH driver, and the VTH driver is what is used in containers. And when it gets this raw XDP frame in, it will actually create an SKB. Then we also have a something called CPU map, where we can redirect these raw frames from the incoming CPU over to another CPU. And then what I'm actually doing there is I'm creating an SKB and then calling the network stack on the remote CPU. And that's quite an efficient way to control what CPU runs the network stack. There's a small hiccup that we don't know the max frame, and we sort of lie about an SKB true size. I think that's fairly easy to fix. Then the stuff that is not easy to fix is that we are lacking these hardware offloads. And right now, like the most obvious ones is the hardware checksum info. And we also have the receive hash. When we don't have that, we have to recalculate the checksum. And I do have a customer that uses the CPU map redirect, and I can see it used 2 to 3% CPU. So they were not too bad. It wasn't too bad for them, because I solved a whole other problem for them with the Q-disk lock, which had, and the system went into a negative scaling issue. So that they were quite happy to get it solved in another way. So that overhead was not too concerning for them. But it is something that we need to solve. So these two small hardware offloads that we pull from the descriptor we get in the driver, they're almost always needed. So I'm very tempted just to extend my XDP frame with those. But there's also other existing offloads that are not always enabled, and we don't want to take the overhead for those, and we also need a solution for those. We have the VLAN, and we have the timestamping. So there's actually sort of two sort of timestamps. We have the hardware timestamps, which is actually stored in the SKB shared info in area that I talked about earlier. And then we have other timestamps that are software timestamps for the in the SKB T stamp that we actually also could play with. We could like set it earlier from the XDP stage. And we also have the receive mark. I think it's only Mellanox that has that, but they're using it fairly extensively. We also have more exotic offloads, which could be interesting. There's a unique 64-bit flow identifier, which I'm interested in, because that could, like the hardware can promise you that it will create a unique ID per flow. And the hardware will do this work, and you can do interesting stuff in software about how you want to sort this. I know Suricata have some use cases for this. Another thing is the hardware has information about the header offloads, and the header offsets. So it could tell me where my TCP header starts, or my UDP header, if this is a UDP packet or not. And it can tell me a lot of other interesting stuff, so I could avoid passing the packet and just jump to the right location. That could also save me some cycles. So I don't want to talk about too much about all these kind of different things. I don't want to. How can we solve this in a more generic way? So I'm looking for a generic and dynamic way to transfer these hardware offload information, and only enable it when I need, because I don't want to take the overhead of copying over an element or a member in a struct if I don't need it. And the challenge is also, I both want to make it available for XKB creation and XDP programs. So some of the big questions that we're going to cover is where to store this information, and how do we actually make it dynamic, and then some notes about what else we are missing. So this slide, I could use some input because I don't know where to store it. I have three different places I could store this information. First of all, we want to avoid allocating a new memory array to store this information in, because then we lost all the performance gain. So we want to find a data area that is already allocated. We could, as a number one is that, like I talked about earlier, we could extend the XDP frame with some information and make this part like dynamic. We have another area I haven't talked about before. It is, we call the XDP metadata area, which is located just in front of the payload start. We currently limited that to 32 bytes. So we could also use that area to store it in. And the last area we have is the tail room at the frame end, which we already use for this, the generic receive offload packets and the multi-frames in general. So if anybody has inputs like David, then, well, the choice is not made yet, but we'll probably discuss it on the mailing list and fight over it, if no one wants to fight now. So how do we make this dynamic? So each driver has their own format for the hardware descriptor. We cannot just export the hardware descriptor directly, because we want to queue it into the VHH, we want to queue it into the other CPU. So this, the hardware descriptor is no longer valid when we reach the other CPU or if we queue this XDP frame. So we do need to store it somewhere in another format. So I don't want to like just copy the hardware descriptor in and then do that. Hopefully, I'm hoping the BTF, the BPF type format, can help describing this structure we want to construct. And it can like describe what the content is in this area. So the easy option, I think, is if a BPF program wants to use this area, we can simply check if it has a matching BTF format that is accessing this area we agree about where we place it. But when the BPF program comes up, I imagine we can have the BTF described from the BPF program, and that we have a BTF from the driver that gets somehow exported, and then we can check if these two are compatible. And I'm sure Alexei have ideas where we can actually remap it if they're not compatible and they have the same off, and we can just rewrite the offsets and really interesting stuff. The thing I haven't wrapped my head around is how can kernel code use this BTF description? If I want to have the kernel code have a C function that understands the BTF type format delivered from the driver, it knows that this is the layout. And then I want my C code to figure out, oh, at this offset, I want to copy these fields over to the SKB. I have to play a little bit more with BTF and get slapped around by Alexei or something.
The kernel itself could call the BPF helpers as well to extract the checksum or the hash or whatever while it's building the SKB.
So you want to do it as a helper?
Because we need the helper anyways for maybe for the XDP program. So when the XDP program, or we could do transparently with loads and stores, right? But we could also have BPF helpers for the kernel sides extract the things out too.
Yeah, I guess.
Because if you want to do this in generic code to build a SKB, right? There has to be this layer of abstraction to get back to the values.
Yeah. Yeah, and another consideration I considered is that I could just do a callback to a BPF program delivered by the driver that knows how the layout is, and then it could populate my SKB fields with another BPF program type, maybe, that understands this. I can't really figure out all the details here. I think we have to try to code it up and then figure out.
It's a device attribute, but at the same time, we want maximum flexibility for location and stuff like that,
yeah.
Especially with the conversation we had over the lunch.
Yeah, and we don't want to lose performance at the same time. If we make it too generic and we have to walk a lot of structures, that's not going to work. So we have one more dependency, that is this multi-frame packets. Yeah. And we've been trying to ignore it for a long time with XDP. We just say, no, we don't support multi-frame packets. This is, if you want to load XDP, the MTU has to be smaller than coarse jumper frames. And the whole reason behind this is that we want a contiguous piece of memory that we can let the verifier say something about if it's safe to access this and give it direct memory access. That's why it's problematic when you have multiple frames in different physical memory pages. But I don't think we can ignore it too much because we actually need it for several use cases. So these multi-frame packets, they could be jumper frames, the TCP segmentation offload you get from the hardware when you get several packets in that are part of a TCP stream. You also have use cases where people want to do a header split. So we can make sure that the driver will split the packet and have the headers in the first segment and then have the data in the next segments, so you can place the data in a separate page, which will allow you to do like zero copy receive stuff. So we do need an answer for this. And also when I want to move SKB allocations completely out of the drivers, I need to have an answer for this because I cannot tell the driver hardware people that actually created this feature that no, we're just disabling this, we're not using it anymore. So I already had some design ideas. I've tried to get some of the Amazon guys to work on it, but let's see what happens if I end up coding it up myself. So let's assume that I fixed all these issues. what do I want to use this XDP frame for before I allocated the SKB? So the general idea is to use this XDP frame for accelerating some fast path. For example, forwarding would be an excellent use case that we could accelerate like non-local host delivery where we don't need to have an SKB and just want to forward it. And then we could fall back and create the SKB for slower path if there's some case that we don't want to handle in the fast path. I must admit that is a lot of work of adjusting different functions to work without SKBs, but we've already seen like a number of changes go into Davis tree where this is happening, where we are adjusting the code to work without SKBs. I think we also have actually the ability to look up a socket from XDP now, where we had to restructure some code there. So one practical use case would to be like having our layer 2 receive handler in the kernel handle these XDP frames. So that some examples of users of the receive handler in the kernel today is bridging and Mac VLAN and EP VLAN and bonding and team. Even OVS is using this hook. And David tells me this is the most abused out-of-tree hook also that people are are hooking into and stealing the package from the network stack at this layer 2. In practice, how the kernel development works, and we have this evolutionary development model, I cannot just assume that everybody will figure out all the these different users. I will have to adjust them to teach them about XDP frames. I'm likely need some kind of new layer 2 receive handler or something else that where I can indicate this is a XDP frame coming in and not an SKB. We also have ideas proposed by Tom Herbert about transport layer XDP. Tom coined the name of XDP. I wanted to call it packet pages, which is really bad. When I had the idea of how we could do this, but packet pages is not a good name. XDP is much better. I think Alexei also was in on that name. So what he's proposing is, and that's the link, the blue one. He's proposing a transport layer XDP, where he wants to lift it up to also do layer 4 handling, which would involve handling a lot of other cases. But for him to gain like any performance gain out of this, he would need to operate on these XDP frames. Otherwise, there's really no advantages of doing it. But the idea is that we could extend it also piecemeal, that we could have fast path for different use cases. For example, for TCP, you could, if it's like just the next, you know, you can see it is the next segment that's coming in for the TCP flow. There's no reason to create an SKB first to queue it on the socket. If you can see that on the socket there's already an existing SKB, we can just use this multi-frame facility and take the XDP frame, because it's just a page, and place it as the next TCP segment, and then increase the TCP's sequence number, and then we're basically done. That would be very fast in the optimal cases. Of course, if there's reordering and TCP packets doesn't come in the right order, we have to fall back to the normal TCP stack. So, a little bit more practical. I also promised you how you can actually use this, because a lot of people complain that this XDP and BPF is hard to use. So, besides working on XDP, I also tried to get to work on making this more consumable for people. And for that, I've created a Git tutorial, a hands-on tutorial, and I claimed that you can simply clone this GitHub repository and run make, or else create GitHub issues that so we can fix it. So you can actually, when you do that, you will actually get a full working test lab on your laptop, and then you can basically, by using looking at the README, you can, and we also have scripts for this that creates the test environment for you. What we do, we create the VHH device and a network namespace. So it's like same technology as from we use for containers, but it's just a simple setup, so you can actually play with this. You can get it up and working. You can write the small exercises of writing BPF code and actually starting to play with these elements, and also discover that you actually have to do some coding yourself. So everybody's like, yeah, I want XDP, this is like 10 times performance. Yeah, but we gave you all this freedom, but the freedom comes that you have to program this yourself. the parser and all this kind of stuff. So it's good to have some examples. That's also part of the idea behind the tutorial. So I have a lot of examples of the different steps and some passing examples also, because as David said, well, everybody now is rewriting the parser steps, and you have to do that manually. So we are sort of hoping to gain some traction to show some examples. We also plan to have one called XDP Tools. It is there, but it's sort of empty, where we hope to make like take some of the tutorial examples and say, this is the way we want to do it, and then write some tools that use this sort of as a library. The thing is, you cannot do it completely as a library, because this is basically header files you want to compile into your BPF program that can gets compiled in and inlined in your code. So that's a very, like, the easiest way I could figure out to give people easy access to a GitHub repository, just git clone this and use it and get XDP up and running without having this dependency on the hardware. We used to have something, we still have something called generic XDP, where you can run it on anything, on any net device, but it's slightly different and there's some pitfalls there that makes it a little bit harder to trust that it also worked when you deployed it in production. When you use the VHH driver, it runs native XDP, even though you don't get the full performance, but you get the feeling and you have much more higher confidence of actually deploying this to production. There's one missing thing, that's the transmit size. So XDP is currently only a single receive hook in the driver, as I talked about. We really want to change that, but it's also a big task. I have no shortage of ideas. So usually we tell people to use the traffic control, the TC BPF egress hook, but I think we can do better. So I do think that we really need a real XDP hook, and there are several reasons for that. One is simply creating symmetry between these hooks, so it's strange you have to write a TC program, has another type than the XDP program, and it's slightly different tools where you hook it in. But the real reason I want it is that XDP redirect, it really needs some kind of pushback or flow control mechanism, because we've created this system where we can really easily shoot ourselves in the foot. Like if we redirect from a 100 gig interface into a 10 gig interface, packets are going to overflow the transmit queue pretty quickly. There's no buffering in there. There's only the hardware transmit queue, the number of elements in the hardware transmit queue of the NIC. And I want a better mechanism to get information about when I'm overrunning that transmit queue. When we are doing this, we have to be careful we don't re-implement the whole queue disk layer. So I want to emphasize that this is not, I'm not trying to reinvent a queue disk layer. It is something that has to be more simple. And I actually, this transmit hook, I actually wanted to run on the normal network stack transmit queues also. And the reason I want that is that we have something called BQL, byte queue limit, which we're using now to block for buffer bloat. And the the byte queue limit works today by detecting how much outstanding, how many outstanding bytes are in the transmit queue, and then it tries to minimize. It tries to strike a balance between there's enough for the hardware to keep busy, but we don't create a large transmit queue which will do head of line blocking and cause these packet transmit delays that we sort of call buffer bloat. Instead, what it does, it pushes back and disables the transmit queue, which when the packet comes down, it sees, oh, this queue is disabled, so I'm starting to queue the packets in the queue disk layer and then start up again. So we could use the same facility for this. I think it will make sense to have the TX hook on normal queues, because we can use the same mechanism of determining when this byte queue limits happen, and we could implement the byte queue limits in as eBPF, and I'm sure if we put a programmability down there, someone else will come up and invent something that is much more interesting than the byte queue limits. We've already seen that people are starting to use hardware facilities where they say to the hardware when they want to transmit, have a transmit timestamp on when this packet has to go out, and then the hardware is responsible for transmitting these packets in the order that we set in software. So that's quite interesting. We could do stuff like that. Another advantage of if drivers sort of goes into this is that we could have the driver transmit queue it would be quite easy to base that on the XDP frame instead of some drivers keep the SKB around until the DMA transmit completion comes around and then freeze the SKB much later at a much later state. And that's we could if drivers are smart about it, some drivers already does this today. They free the SKB earlier and then just take the page and the length and the offset and say to the hardware, here it is. And then when the hardware comes back and says, I've transmitted this, they free the page. And we should encourage driver developers to do that because we want to shorten how long the SKB is alive, because it's pretty bad if the cache lines goes cold and all this kind of stuff. Yeah. And I actually think this is my end slide. Yeah. So in summary, now we have a fully programmable network fast path and we can now compete with the kernel bypass piece, which is really nice. But as you did notice in my slides, there's still a lot of development work ahead. It is usable, and Facebook have been running there for, soon 2 years or in production, more. Yeah, so there have been some of the first adopters, and Cloudflare is also running this. But there's still a lot of interesting work ahead. I do think we want to move this in a direction where we collaborate more with the network stack. Like this, we want to encourage people to do this helpers, to access the kernel tables in different ways, and that is kind of important. But it's also important that people engage with us and just to get these facilities in. Some it is possible to just do the BPF maps and not talk to the kernel community. But it's my claim that we will get better solutions if people want to cooperate and say we have this use case for this helper, and then we'll talk about it and figure it out. And then it will also be interesting to see how far I can take this. Like, is it really realistic that I want to put the SKBs outside the drivers and stuff like that? And if you want to join the fund, because as you can see, I have more projects than I can do myself, we have created a project coordination also on GitHub, where you can go and see if you want to join the fund. So thank you. So, any questions? Any questions? I mean, quickly.
Regarding the metadata that you need on the RX path and that you don't know where to store in the frame.
Yeah.
In Endive, we solve this differently by not storing this data in the frame, but only in registers that are passed as arguments to the functions called. And it's not that bad in the end because the size of this metadata is quite small. If you only focus on what is really important, and by important I mean what is expensive to rebuild if you don't pass it, in fact you don't have that much. So it can be an option.
Yeah, that's an interesting suggestion. One problem is that we want to sort of the creation of the SKB happens much later in the stack. It could happen on a remote CPU, so we need to store this information. I could, if I want to do the CPU map redirect, I would have to store this information somewhere anyhow.
Also, another use case that comes up is a lot of these networking cards have a parser tree. You already know it's a TCP packet. They already know that the offset is this. They already know the data length is this, and they're going to pluck all this information into a descriptor. And this is the kind of stuff we might want to pass as well.
Yeah, that's exactly what Endiv does. It and I've read your code, so it puts it into some in the call registers, and then compresses more information into the space.
Because one thing you can do is actually have variable XDP code generation, where if you know you're going to get the full parse tree, you don't have to parse anything. You just make a decision based upon data in your BPF maps or something like that. So you'll have the source IP address already from the metadata, and you just go, yes, drop this packet. It's a bad packet.
Yeah, there's a lot of potential. So this question.
So, question about your proposal for dynamic metadata.
Yeah.
So, I guess you want the same metadata mapping for every queue, every device's port. Otherwise, you cannot do some forward from one port to the other one.
So you're saying I want it for all the queues, or?
Yeah, I'm saying probably you want the same mapping all over the system, using the same metadata for every device.
I want to have it much more dynamic. I want for every hardware NIC. I want to give me a BTF format description of the info that it will populate, and they can have another NIC from another vendor that produces something else. That's
okay. So this is defined when you configure the queue or the device.
Yeah. When you configure the queue, you want, like, ultimately you could have it per receive queue. It could have different information, but I'm not sure we have that. That would complicate the code a bit and the interfaces. So I'm not sure we want to go that way. But if there's a use case for it. There's a question?
As I understand it, with BTF, you could say this field is at this offset, and that's allowed to vary. But I don't think you'll be able to handle things like if you have if the completion tells you which protocol the packet was parsed as. That the enumeration of protocol numbers, it's going to differ between hardware, and I don't know how you would, don't know that you could actually handle that easily, or even express that in BTF.
So the different type of, like, it's TCP or UDP, or that's what you're talking about?
Sort of thing, yes.
Yeah, I don't know how we would choose to express that, but I think you would just say that maybe you use 8 bytes for that, and that information that's stored in this offset about this is the type of the packet. I think that's how I would like do it. So I think that's the last question. I'm not allowed to. You can come talk to me. Thank you.